This is an oral history interview conducted for the Witness to War Serving a Nation project at Nauset Regional High School on Cape Cod, Massachusetts. For the sake of this interview, please state your full name and community in which you now reside.
Joseph Francis McCarthy, Ipswich, Massachusetts.
Thank you. All right. So where did you grow up?
South Boston, Massachusetts.
Okay. Can you tell me like a little bit about your childhood?
I grew up in the 1950s to the 1960s where there was a substantial amount of influence from those from World War II Korea. It was a basic middle class neighborhood, and growing up was like most any other community at that time. A substantial amount of children in the homes, usually 5 to 7, living in a single family flat. Just enjoying life. Nobody knew we were poor. Nobody felt we were poor. And that's pretty much how things were around here.
When you were a child, what did you want to be when you grew up?
At the age of high school, whatever, grade 9, I wanted to be an electrician. During the process, I went to Don Bosco High School, and I graduated with an electrician's certificate so I could get my license to practice in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. There was a rather transformation. I felt I wanted to be a businessman by the time I was 50 or 60 years old, using all the electrical experience that I would gain through that time to start some type of business venture.
All right, thank you. Why did you join the military?
That's a good question. I felt obligated. It was something that I had a burning desire, especially after hearing from my father and little episodes that he had in Korea. So I felt, one, an obligation, two, a burning desire.
What branch did you serve in?
In the Marine Corps.
Okay. And what was your rank and how did you achieve it?
I was a corporal over 4 years of active duty. Rank is achieved in a couple of fashions. One, it could be achieved meritoriously, or it is achieved through time and rank. Time and rank is a situation where you gather points, have so much time in each rank, and you're promoted. I get enough time?
You're good. Okay.
And you're promoted through that type of process. It's called the time and rank. And then there's the other type of process. It's called the meritorious promotion. Meritorious promotions are given for excellent, how would you say, excellent performance.
What were some of your main responsibilities and duties?
Duties vary with different rank structures. So, as a Lance Corporal, a private PFC, a Lance Corporal, the primary duties were to ensure that all the equipment that we were using had preventive maintenance done in a timely fashion so that when it was to go out in the field, we would know that the equipment was working properly. We would have to do test runs. And the non-commissioned officer who was in charge of those other enlisted individuals would ensure that the equipment does get done. He would do the directing, he would do the scheduling, and ensure that everything is in place. He's a non-commissioned officer that rather gives the orders on a lower level.
Thank you. Was there anything unique or different or abnormal about what you did in your position?
I did everything that was expected and nothing less that the commanding officer would do himself. Would he expect out of me?
What was the medical care like?
Good medical care. I had not an issue with medical care. When you're in a field situation, when you're on deployment, when you're not at garrison, it's very important to stay healthy. So when issues arrive with regards to possibly cuts, so much as even blisters on your feet because you're out in the possibly jungle for days and months at a time, they take very good care of you. Very good care of you, because you have to stay healthy to be effective.
What was an everyday meal like?
It usually started off in the morning, somewhere around 0500 or so. It would be full of protein, grits, potatoes, rice, omelets, any type you want. You would have eggs, any type you want. You would have pancakes, waffles, high protein.
All right. How did you keep in contact with your loved ones and family?
When you're stateside, back then, it was landlines. There were no cell phones. We contacted each other by collect calls. That was what happened stateside. When we shifted to the overseas, at that time, there were no telephone lines over in Southeast Asia. I would have to call back on a two-way radio.
Okay.
1976 it was, I think.
What was one of your best or happiest memories?
Let's say that coming home.
And why was that?
It was a very difficult situation where back in 76 and 77, there was still a substantial amount of resistance to the military. There were still people spitting on you when you came home from overseas, especially Asia. There was a California group of people that tend to protest a little bit heavier, and that's where our deportation, departing places were, so it was very easy for people to congregate. Coming home, just happy to be alive.
That's good. What's like one of your biggest memories or most memorable things that happened?
Falling from the sky and getting the order to fix bayonets.
Could you elaborate on that a little more?
No.
Okay, thank you. When was the last time you were in contact with someone that you served with?
About 30 days ago.
And what did that contact consist of?
Just talking about his boy who was in Marine Corps too, who ended up in Fallujah.
How has serving affected your life today?
Yeah, what it does is it put life in perspective. Years ago, when the mission was to seek, destroy, and total annihilation of the enemy with small arms firing, hand-to-hand combat, today's mission would be a preservation of life.
Okay. What is your current occupation, and how did you end up there?
I'm retired from the electrical union.
Could you elaborate a little more on what you were doing in the military and what was going on?
I had two phases of operations. One was Southeast Asia and one was a NATO operation that took place back in 1978. The first operation in Southeast Asia involved a helicopter crash and working in a rather unnoticed obligation with the Filipino government with regards to surveillance and enforcement of some of international rules. Then there was operations in the other part of Europe where I was attached to a Marine Air Control Squadron, where we were responsible for tracking down Soviet MiGs once the word was given that they were flying from some type of Soviet airport somewhere around the Baltic. that time, the world was rather divided, very Cold War-ish, and Europe had the Iron Wall. I don't know if you know what the Iron Wall is, the Iron Curtain. That was when the Soviets split up East Germany and West Germany, Poland, all these Soviet bloc nations. Almost overnight, the Iron Curtain was put up. And that was my job towards the end when we were involved in NATO operations to keep track of where these Soviet MiGs were flying. It was always a dog-eat-dog situation at that time. While on float, you could even see the MiGs doing dogfights with our fighter pilots. So those situations tend to be rewarding because of the ability to stop a strike versus it's a preempting that was satisfying for me.
And why was that? Why was it so satisfying?
Because the ability to, as the drones are today, to be stealth, we were stealth then. And that gave us a sense of invincibility.
Could you tell me a little bit about the medals on your shirt, on your, right here?
That's, well, one is a good conduct ribbon, the other one is national defense, and the national defense is given for service in a war zone, service in, under defense on emergencies, and one is for a sea duty, overseas duty. The other two are just for being a good Marine, that's all.
How are they earned?
They're given through accommodations, meritorious mass for work that is, I guess, above and beyond what the average Marine would be at your rank. So, that's I gave you the meritorious mass. You can read them if you want. So,
okay. What was some of your training like that you went through?
There were multiple layers of training. First level of training was boot camp. It was 77 days of psychological, physical, emotional training where you would go from a civilian thinking of yourself to a cog in the wheel where everybody moves at the same. Everybody has the same responsibility. And you work as a team. It instills a different type of character in you, far only those that have gone through it would understand.
All right. If someone close to you said they were thinking about serving for a country, what would you tell them?
Not a problem, going as an officer.
And why would that be?
Officers have a tendency to have life a little bit easier. They are not enlisted. They have special privileges, and rightfully so.
What are some of those special privileges?
Some of their eating facilities, instead of it being self-serve, they have servers. Their living quarters are private, not a squad bay of maybe 40. And just through their ability to lead, rank has its privileges.
Okay. So. What was your rank like?
I was a corporal. I was a non-commissioned officer.
What is that?
I was, it's called an E4. It's, we have to have the ability to lead at a moment's notice, but, we're not commissioned like how an officer is commissioned by the by Congress. So
okay.
We're enlisted.
Mm-hmm. And how many years did you serve for?
4 years and I don't know if it was 6 months or 3 months.
And how come you stopped serving?
I was medically discharged.
Okay. Could you tell me a little more about that?
I was in a helicopter crash, and my ankles got pretty banged up. And it was decided that because of that helicopter crash, I should have some operations, because I was having difficulties walking, difficulties just performing. So.
Does that still affect you today?
Today it does. Mm-hmm.
What was the most interesting thing that happened to you?
The most interesting thing that happened to me was having the opportunity to see the world, to see Singapore, Hong Kong, the Philippines, Germany, Denmark, Scotland, Sweden, all those that I don't know if we went to Sweden, but all the areas over there that I would not have had the opportunity as a kid growing up in South Boston to experience this international lifestyle. So, being on a flotilla, it allowed exposure. With that exposure, I grew. I grew as a person. I came back and had a different outlook in life. Coming from an area where it's an all-white area, growing up, and having to relocate yourself to a white-black area, and then relocating yourself overseas to an area of white-black oriental, white-black European oriental, it gives you tolerance. And that's what develops while you're exposed to those type of conditions. It gives you tolerance and allows you to bring that education back. Very difficult to explain to somebody what it's like to be in Hong Kong. When you're looking down the street, everybody is 5'2", jet black hair. And when you see somebody who's a little taller and a blonde or gray hair, you know that's not the typical person. But it's accepted. And that's what allowed me to really grow, to be diversified, to be able to join in with those people, not feeling I was the outcast.
What was your favorite place you traveled to or saw?
The Netherlands, Amsterdam.
How come it was your favorite? What did you like about it, or what were you doing there?
We were on a Liberty session. It just tend to be the most receptive socially, and probably economically too, of our whole tour.
Did you have a lot of friends, or were you close with the people you were serving with?
You're pretty close with the people you're serving with. You sleep with them, you work with them, you eat, drink, you know everything about them. Everything.
If you went back in time, would you do it again, or would you decide not to do it?
Do it again. Go ahead, turn it off and ask some questions.
What were your sleeping conditions like?
Sleeping conditions were very comfortable when we were at Garrison. Garrison is when you're in the back of the field doing your training at your training depots. Very comfortable. You have your own beds, you have your own foot lockers, your own lockers. It's as if you're living in a dormitory or a suite now, okay? If you go to college, you live in a two-room suite. That would be the conditions that we lived in. But when you were in the field, you made the conditions. Sometimes you didn't sleep. Sometimes you slept sitting up. Sometimes you had to watch. Everybody has watch, so.
What was being in the field like?
Very unique. We were trained to be there to understand the whole military technique of evasiveness, of assault, of survival. To me, it was rather a very smooth way of living, very not so complicated. As a matter of fact, I almost enjoyed it.
Why would you say you enjoyed it?
It was simple.
Was there anything you encountered that you were not trained for or didn't know how to handle?
No, because if there was something I didn't know how to handle, somebody else that was with me did.
What were some of the things you wouldn't know how to handle?
Well, situations that other Marines have been in with regards to, let's say, a helicopter crash where somebody who had been in a situation like that would know exact procedure to follow, how to exit, who was in charge of the craft. That's huge, and not until you learn from those that are teaching you do you understand. Until you see that happen, it just brings in a seasoned body into you. It's very difficult to explain how, if you were to crash, the seasoned Marine would know exactly what to do, how to get out, who to direct the orders to, where somebody who was not so seasoned would follow the direction of that seasoned individual.
What were those procedures like? What happened?
Simple procedures would be set perimeters. You would exit the plane, aircraft, secure the aircraft so that the U.S. military can come and take the aircraft away that's damaged.
Was help available quickly after, or were you waiting a long time for help?
Sometimes it was available, sometimes it wasn't.
So, you brought some things that you had with you when you served. Would you like to tell us about them?
This is called deuce gear. It's just equipment given to the basic Marine back then that would allow him to survive in the wilderness on combat. This right here is your basic backpack. Inside the backpack here has got a it has a special pocket that's supposed to allow everything else to get wet except for the product in that pocket.
And what kinds of things would you keep in that pocket?
You would keep anything you want to keep not being wet. Underpants, a couple pair of socks, maybe a t-shirt. Just enough so that if you were to get wet or cold, that you could throw something else on that would be dry. Inside here would be, there's three pockets on the outside. These three pockets are designed so that you could put food, you could put any type of special, maybe healthcare products you want, toothbrushes, things of that nature. The soap that they used to give us was soap that was made of the same soap that you would use in the jungle. So most of our equipment was designed for smell that would assimilate us into the jungle itself.
And what are those other things you have?
This right here is a, it's called a, belt, an ammunition belt, okay? What this here is, it's adjustable by hooks and by slides here. And on this belt, what you usually have is a pouch here. Remember, this is old style, nothing like today's technology, where you would put a canteen. You would like to go out with two canteens all the time.
Canteens of what?
Water.
Okay.
Nothing but water. And then along with that, you would have your basic ammunition pouch. Ammunition pouch carries 3 20-round magazine clips for an M16. 5.56 rounds. It's a NATO operating round, so that if there should be any issues working with our NATO-friendly allies, the ammunition would be the same. Where the Soviets' ammunition is primarily a 7.62 round, either 7.62 by 39 or 7.62 by 79.
And were you in combat? Were you on the first line ever?
No, my operations were rather of a stealth nature.
And what was that like? What did that consist of?
We were never there.
Okay. You have your code of conduct. Would you like to explain about that a little more and what it consisted of?
I guess it's all about discipline, ensuring that everybody gets treated the same. It's how you're supposed to act under severe conditions. The what does it say on the second article?
I will never surrender of my own free will if I'm
You got the message there. I will never surrender with my own free will. In the first article, it says that I am an American fighting man and I have to take responsibility for my actions.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the articles in the code of conduct, so.
Was it ever hard to follow, or were you ever faced with any challenges with them?
Not difficult to follow. It is what it is, and that's just, you know, going into it.
Mm-hmm. And everyone had the same code of conduct?
I believe everybody who was with me believed in the same code of conduct.
Yeah. These dog tags here, what were they used for, and what was the purpose of them?
The dog tags are used for identification. It says your name, social security number. It gives you your gas mask size. I think it says M there. And it says the religion, Roman Catholic. So those are your identification tags, so that when you become a casualty, you either have that installed on your toe or it's stuck in your palate between your two front teeth. So.
And you always had them with you?
You always had them on you. They were, if you notice that there is some rubber that's around there that's worn off. It was very important back then to ensure that there was no noise being made through jingling, and so we would tape them and rubber them up so that they wouldn't make jingle noise against them.
Did you carry any photographs or memorabilia from you back home?
Nope.
Nothing?
No.
This photo, you said it was your backpack. Would you care to explain what was in it?
6 rotary telephones, along with wire and possibly wire supports there. What that was is I was a wireman in charge of a company which would allow us to move. Once we made a move, we would pack up our equipment, make the move to another position, and then we would reinstall communications between each one of the platoons.
And how would you install those?
Run wires in between each platoon and bring it terminated back at the command post. That way the command post had the opportunity to talk to all of the company commanders.
When it was time to pack it up again and move, how would you transport all your equipment?
I would put it on my backpack and move it on my back.
Was that challenging?
At the beginning it was challenging, but it got to be very routine.
How many people did you have in your unit with you?
There is, I was attached to a H&S company, which is a headquarters and service company. We were in a, I believe, what I was attached to was a golf company. Golf company had three platoons and a weapons platoon. So it would be 39 times 4, whatever that would be. 40 times 4 would be about 150-something people that were attached to each company. And each company would have their own weapon.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much for this interview. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
No problem.